Cagayan Governor Manuel Mamba apologizes after a controversial remark that disparaged Muslims. During Wednesday's Senate hearing on flood control projects, Mamba had appealed for help from lawmakers to rehabilitate the Cagayan River to entice tourists and investors there. But in his attempt to convince lawmakers to help the flood-hit province, the governor linked the peace and order situation there to the alleged absence of Muslims. Hours after the hearing, the Cagayan Public Information Office clarified the governor actually meant it was peaceful in the province because there were no extremists in the Muslim community there. Well, Governor Mamba has since apologized, as we reported, but should the discussion end there? We're going to talk now to Zia Alonto Adiong about the systemic prejudice against Muslims here in the country. He is a member of parliament of the Bangsamoro Transition Authority. Zia, welcome to the program. Nice to see you again.
Hi, Carmina. How are you?
I'm good. How about yourself?
I'm fine. Happy to be here.
Yeah, well, you put out a lengthy tweet after what the governor said yesterday. And you did say the discussion, in so many words, shouldn't end with the apology, as we have to look into the deeply rooted systemic prejudice against Muslims here in the country. The question is, Zia, how do we begin to break down the barriers and rid the system of prejudice against Muslims?
Well, I think we should start from the basic. We have to know exactly what we mean when we say Muslim. We need to avoid associating that with extremists and violent and the terrorism. We have to have at least a proper usage of nomenclatures. When you say Muslim, it means a person who obeys God, who does the will of God, who is peace-loving, who does not condone or tolerate terrorism or violent extremism. So if you link that with a word that is the actual opposite of what it means to be Muslim, then you would have a problem. And so I think this shouldn't be limited to peace negotiation or interreligious activity. It is very personal. Many of us have felt discrimination and stereotypes, especially those of us who've been living in highly urbanized areas like in Metro Manila. And so I guess this is very systematic in a way that many people who do not understand really the experience of being or have the experience of having to defend yourself, even your presence in a peaceful community. I think it's time for the majority of our kababayan to look at the optics of what really it means to struggle as a minority in this country. And that should begin by looking at the optics, what we see on the ground based on the experiences of the people who are actually suffering prejudice, stereotypes, and biases.
Zia, I know that you have forgiven the remarks of the Cagayan governor because that is part of your faith. Your faith calls for that, to forgive. But I'd have to go back to the apology that was issued, because in it still lies this sort of misunderstanding of what a Muslim is, because they still put the extremist word there. They still said that there are no extremists in the Muslim community, sort of saying that if there is a Muslim community, then it is understood that there may be the presence of extremists there.
That is actually what I'm talking about, no? The problem with identifying the word to extremism or to terrorism. I think it should be unlearned, no? We should start from eradicating that from our system. It's extremism. The word extremism is something that should not be limited or to be associated directly with a specific religious order. Mm-hmm. There have been many cases of other ideas and other platforms and advocacies which tends to makes people to lean to some extreme position. It depends on how a person really develop its, what you call that, it develop its own, you know, passion, how passionate the person is in trying to advocate a certain principles. And that would tend the person to be extremist in a way. Mm. So I guess by implying that a presence of a Muslim in the community would open the portal for extremists is something that is really disheartening and appalling at the very, you know, it's very appalling. To say the least, because we've been how many Muslims now in the Philippines in terms of population? If all of us have a tendency or potential to be extremists, then you would the country would have a serious problem, national security problem. We've been partners with the with the Philippine government. We've all NGOs organizations. We've been part of inter dialogue, religious dialogue. We actually disassociate ourselves from terrorist organizations, and that would be that would give our other people the impression that we do not tolerate and we do not actually condone. Regardless who does the crime, it does not matter whether he is a non-Muslim or a Christian or a Muslim. For as long as we should have to put an end to this, a terrorist is a terrorist. There's no religious qualifier to that, and that's very basic. And we should understand that, and we should put that into ourselves. Again, there's so many things that we have to learn, and so many things also we have to learn. This distance ourselves from this kind of system, from these stereotypes.
I'm going to, at this point, read a portion of your tweet. As you said, you sent out a series of tweets yesterday. You said there are Muslim diplomats, Muslim businessmen, Muslim doctors, Muslim scientists, inventors, academicians, legislators, and so on. You name it, we have it. We even have Muslim heads of state. There are also Muslims of various nationalities and race. But despite this picture, there's still prejudice. It still remains. Why do you think here in the country that prejudice remains?
Well, it takes for us, Carmina, to sit down for a day to discuss. No, it goes down to history, I guess, the mistrust and the suspicion. No, if you ask me, it goes back as far as the Spanish colonization, you know, the Moro-Moro, the Zarzuela, the Moro-Moro, depicting the Moros, pirates and buccaneers and, you know, all of this sort, no? All of the negative connotations that they try to link to being a Moro. Mm. So I guess that caused a deep resentment and deep suspicion amongst ourselves. So if you go back to that, and presently, it has developed into a notion. Sometimes it comes out as a joke, you know?
Correct.
Wag kayong pumunta ng... Safe ba dyan? Pag pumunta kami dyan? Mm. So this may be benign and this may be harmless, but, you know, it's driven from the deep-seated suspicion and mistrust. Mm. So I think we should unlearn, no? It's through education. And we realize that there's more should be done in the on the field of religious understanding and tolerance. I think it's a part of our sabi ko nga, it should not be limited to political realm, no? It should be personal.
Correct.
It should be personal because the insult is really, really personal.
Mm. Kasi yung halimbawa, Zia, pag sinabing moro-moro lang yan.
That is exactly what I'm trying to say. Na it comes out as a joke,
right? You know,
sometimes it may be harmless, but looking at the impact and the insult and the offense that it may create to another person, you're masakit yon.
Mm.
Masakit because religion, Islam is a way of life. It's not a cultural identity. It's a belief. It's a way of life.
What is painful, I guess, as well, Zia, is that despite the headway, something like this happens and you go back to zero again. And then the younger generation sees it. You raise the young in this community. You teach them the teachings, the religion, the faith. and then this happens, and you sort of go back and try to explain to them again. But I want to hear it from you. What is the effect of something like this on the younger generation?
Mm-hmm. Well, it makes it, in a way, let me put it this way. If we casually say that, you know, Muslims are, you know, we are peaceful here, we have no problem in terms of our security because we don't have Muslim extremists in our area, that in a way will normalize the stereotypes. It would begin to, it shows us a certain degree of acceptance, which is dangerous, you know. Any sign of stereotypes, misconception, biases should not be tolerated, even if it made as a joke, even if it made, if you think that it was done, you know, without intention of malice, it should not, it must not be tolerated. So the problem with that kind of statement is that it promotes acceptance of mistrust and stereotypes and prejudice, which we are trying to break. So I guess we should, sabi ko nga, we should be more careful and make it as a personal mission to help promote understanding. We should not, you know, depend on our officials alone to make this happen for us. All of us should make it as our personal mission to promote understanding and break mistrust and stereotypes against minorities in this country.
You said in your tweet last night, you are a Muslim. You have all the right as a citizen of this country under this constitution to choose to live wherever you see fit. Do not allow people to tell you you are the problem. Do not afford them that right. I mean, it boggles the mind that in this day and age, you still have to verbalize that, Zia. You still have to make that reminder.
Well, it's an expected occurrence now in every country you go. This has been the experience of many minorities across the globe, not only here in the Philippines, but even far advanced developed nations. We see minorities, you know, fighting for their rights, trying to do anything they can in order to be heard. So it may go different various levels. Like it could be economic issue, it could be racial issue, it could be employment, etc. But this is in fact one of the challenges of being a minority in a particular setup, in this case in the Philippines. Although there's a separation of the church and the state, but largely Philippines is predominantly Christian in character. Mm. So we believe that there's much to be done, but we cannot accomplish anything. And we cannot be successful in this without the support of the majority of our kababayan, of our countrymen, especially those who are coming out from outside of our territory.
Well, clearly, as you put it, there is much left to be desired. Let's not talk to those who have bigoted minds, Zia. I want you to talk to the young Muslims. I want you to give your message to them. What does this recent incident teach them?
Well, again, they should be, you know, ultimately, we have to prove these, you know, these misconceptions. We have to prove them wrong. Many people do not read the Quran. We don't expect them to read the Hadith. We don't expect them to go in a class and sit down and discuss religious matters or be able to learn more, you know, in a conventional educational setup. But they based mostly their perception and their judgment on what they see. So I guess it falls upon us the challenge of proving them wrong. It's not that we owe them, no, we owe the people that kind of explanation, but we owe to ourselves to prove that we are indeed peace-loving people, and that in a way would prove them wrong.
Zia Alonto Adiong of the Bangsamoro Transition Authority, we thank you for your time. Always a pleasure talking to you. You keep safe.
Thank you very much, Carmina. Pleasure to be with you.